welcome to worship this morning. It's good to be together on yet another cold January day. I've just a couple announcements as we gather, just to draw your attention to the calendar in your bulletin and to remind you that Wolfboro Reads starts on Tuesday afternoon. We'll be reading The Hate You Give by Angie Thomas. So this was the young adult book of the year for 2017. I know it's 444 pages long, but it's a fast read. I plowed through the first 150 pages in just a couple hours. So don't be intimidated by its size and its depth. It should be a thoughtful and a good conversation, and so we'll do 3 weeks on that book starting this Tuesday. Are there other announcements to share with one another as we gather this morning? All right, then, let us be in a spirit of worship as we begin with our prayer.
Please join me in the call to worship. God has made everything suitable for its time.
God has made us, and we are fearfully and wonderfully made.
God has given us a sense of past, present, and future.
Yet what we know is so small compared to the infinite wisdom of God.
It is God's gift that that we find peace and joy in this lifetime.
Whatever God does endures forever.
Come before God with awe and wonder.
Worship God, who has given us eternal life.
Our opening hymn is Sweet Spirit, 293 in the Black Hymnal.
Thank you.
a cold day. That's okay.
Yes. There was no tearing open the ceiling, thank God. And there were no dogs. And there was no super loud voice. But we do think that something mysterious happens when we get baptized. We don't really know what it is, but we believe we hear God, or we see God, or we know something of God that's special and mysterious and only happens when we get baptized. What would you imagine that God would want to say to you?
Dedicated, named, claimed, and enjoyed.
anointed for the work of love in the world. And what it will require of Jesus, and what that work will ask of him, is his all. His life, his death, his suffering, and his redemption. So listen as you hear this original story of Jesus' baptism for those things that we just talked about. The voice, the wilderness, the heavens torn open, the Son of God. From the Gospel of Mark. John the Baptist was in the wilderness, calling for people to be baptized, to show that they were changing their hearts and lives and wanted God to forgive their sins. Everyone in Judea and all the people of Jerusalem went out to the River Jordan and were being baptized by John as they confessed their sins. John wore clothes made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist. He ate locusts and wild honey. He announced, "One stronger than I is coming after me. I'm not even worthy to bend over and loosen the straps of his sandals. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." About that time, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee, and John baptized him in the Jordan River. While he was coming up out of the water, Jesus saw heaven splitting open, and the Spirit like a dove coming down on him. And there was a voice from the heavens, "You are my Son, whom I dearly love. In you I find happiness." Here ends our reading from the Gospel of Mark. In this reading from the book of Acts, you'll hear the beginning of the debate about what baptism is legit. Baptism with water or baptism by the Spirit? It certainly hints for us that the early church congregations were not all of one unified practice. Not that different, perhaps, than our own modern era. The essence of Paul's question in this passage, though, is not how you were baptized by water or Spirit, but have you received the Holy Spirit? For Paul, this is a much more important question, and it should be for us, too. From the 19th chapter of the book of Acts, verses 1 to 7. While Apollos was in Corinth, Paul took a route through the interior and came to Ephesus, where he found some disciples, and he asked them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you came to believe?" They replied, "We've not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit." Then he said, "What baptism did you receive then?" And they answered, "John's baptism." Paul explained, John baptized with a baptism by which people showed they were changing their hearts and their lives. It was a baptism that told people about the one who was coming after. This is the one in whom they were to believe. This one is Jesus. After they listened to Paul, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul placed his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came. The Holy Spirit came on them, and they began speaking in other languages and prophesying. Altogether, there were about 12 people. Here ends our reading this morning in the book of Acts and from the Gospel of Mark. May God add blessing indeed to the reading of these words. Would you join me in the Spirit of prayer? Gracious and holy God, it takes us indeed a lifetime to consider the blessings that you bestow upon us, blessings of water and blessings of Spirit, promises of baptism, and lives that are modeled before us in one another to change the world, to love with the wholeness of our being, to trust that you walk with us in all that we do and all that we are. May the meditations of my heart and the words on my lips be pleasing and acceptable in your sight, my Savior and Redeemer. Amen. Well, as many of you know, I was at a funeral yesterday, calling hours the night before, for the husband of a dear and good and abiding friend. As so often happens when we gather at the end of our mutual lives and we remember those that we have known or thought that we knew in the fullness of their years, we tell stories. We share stories that have perhaps been stories that our friends or our loved ones have told time and time again. And inevitably in the sharing of such stories, we learn that other people didn't know that story, or some people heard a slightly different version of that story over the years. And we begin to question, which one is true, which one was not? And when a family gathers, you get to compare notes One of the stories that got told again and again yesterday was the story about Bob and his bountiful garden and the rabbit. So Bob was a proficient and beautiful gardener. He would tell the story of one year at his cottage by the water in Rhode Island. He built up a fence. He had this type of fencing that had small holes at the bottom of the fence. So the fence was very tightly woven at the bottom. And as the fence grew up and was taller, the holes got a little bigger, perhaps with the belief that small animals would try to get in from the bottom and larger animals from the top, so you could vary the size of the holes. So that summer, time would go on, and Bob would find again and again that something had been eating his garden. His vegetables were disappearing. And Bob would complain and mutter and sputter about how he had this fencing. How could anything be getting into his garden? So he would complain to friends and to family alike what was happening, what was going on in the garden. So one day, Bob decided he would sit on his porch and he would watch until he got an answer to what was happening to the vegetables in his garden. And as he watched and witnessed as this rather large-sized bunny rabbit came coming along, approached the fence, and managed to climb its way up the fence, using each hole, first the small and then the large, as foot and paw holes to get up to the size of the hole in the fence, which the rabbit could fit through. The rabbit then flipped itself into the garden and proceeded to have a bountiful feast on Bob's vegetables. Well, sometimes when Bob told this story, he would say that it was then and there that he went and got his .22 and shot that rabbit right there for eating his vegetables. And sometimes when Bob would tell this story, he would say he decided the cleverness of such a bunny should be rewarded, and he would let the bunny live on and feast on his vegetables. Yesterday, the family and friends told dueling stories. Bob's stories, Bob's own words and stories, come back to compare and to contrast which part of the story was true and which part of the story had changed over time. We do this, I think, in our remembering that's not always so perfect. We certainly do this in the Bible. I'm right, you're wrong. We're hardwired to dismiss evidence and opinions that contradict our own. Generally, this is a good practice. I mean, if someone were to come in and tell you that pigs were flying in the sky outside, you would think them either crazy or lying. But it also means it's really hard for us to influence one another, to change our made-up minds about things. How do we see that? In our religion, in our politics, in the news, around our dinner tables, in our social media feeds. But surely, it must also be necessary for us to be able to learn new things, to learn that we are wrong about some things, to change our minds. I have learned over these recent weeks one perspective from a neurologist and psychologist who were on a podcast called The Hidden Brain, talking about how it is that we truly can hear one another. Turns out the power of a story is bigger than you might think. When we share stories, we allow one another to experience emotion from another perspective. When we begin to tell stories of our lives or other people's lives, we sort of sync up. Our brains start to anticipate where the story might go. We begin to feel emotions together as the story unravels. It encourages us to hear one another better, especially if we are of different belief or politic or inclination. I think of this as I hear this passage from Acts. We get this glimpse into this time-old debate. What is the right way to be baptized? Water, spirit, water, spirit. We could add infant, believer, child, adult, outside, in a church, in worship, at a time apart. So, we need to look a little deeper. Water has always been a powerful symbol in our scriptures. From Genesis to Revelation, water arcs through the Bible, courses through the scriptures, shapes the landscape of our sacred text, surfaces again and again in the story of the people of God. Nearly always, water is a sign of God's provision, of God's providence and God's care for those whom God has claimed. By the time we see Jesus, meeting John at the River Jordan in this Sunday's gospel passage, we've already been swimming in story. We have heard of God giving a stream to Eden. We have heard of Hagar receiving wellsprings in her desperate wilderness. We've heard of Moses striking the rock that gave water to a thirsty and a wandering people. We have read tales of Jacob meeting Rachel by a well. We've heard the psalmist's words about still waters that comfort and restore, and a prophet's proclamation of a God who will pour water on thirsty land and streams on the dry ground. Again and again, God's provision breaks through and springs forth in the form of water. And here, in Mark's gospel, this first time Jesus takes the stage as an adult, we see him come to the River Jordan, a river which, for generations before, priests bore the Ark of the Covenant to stand, stopping water so that entire long-journeying children of Israel could pass through to the other side, a river that Elijah struck with his mantle so that he and Elisha could cross moments before Elijah's dramatic ascension amid blazing horse and chariot of fire. It is the Jordan that Elisha tells the leprous Naaman to wash himself in and be cleansed, the Jordan that King David crosses with all of Israel as he prepares to fight the Arameans, the Jordan that traces a path through Israel's history, a mythic river that Jesus wades into, and we watch him become drenched in very real waters as he receives John's baptism. As Jesus rises from an ancient river, he becomes the recipient of all the graces that water signifies, imbued with layers of symbolism and story and blessing that waters convey. He's not only the recipient of it, as waters of baptism roll off of him, he becomes for us the actual sign. This drenched and dripping Messiah embodies and shows forth in fullness just how far God will go to provide for and restore God's people. Well, lovely. So what? Here at the Jordan, our eyes perhaps also are drawn to the yielding that takes place in this moment. I'm always struck by the way the story unfolds. When Jesus first approaches John, John challenges this baptism-seeking Savior. John says, "I should be baptized by you. You come to me?" But Jesus says, "Let it be so." Now, Jesus urges him, his words an echo of this "let it be" that Mary, the mother of Jesus, offers to the angel so long before that, on a day that the same Spirit descended upon her. And just like that, the locust and honey-eating Baptist of the wilderness, who only a few verses earlier was railing at Pharisees and Sadducees and speaking of vipers and axes, winnowing forks and fire, falls silent. He gives in. He changes his mind. He says, "I was wrong, and you are right." He yields to Jesus, like a stone yielding to the river that washes over it. This yielding calls forth a courage, both of recognizing the path to which we're called and ceasing to fight against it, to give ourselves over to its flow, to let it work on us and change us as a river does with a stone. So, water, spirit, adult, child, John, Jesus, I don't know about you, but what always stays with me from this story and from the early church questions in Acts is the voice of God, the dove that proclaims Jesus as beloved, named and claimed, blessed, sent forth in some mysteriously different way because of what happens in the Jordan that day. The wilderness of John the Baptist, who gathers people and crowds, followers, perhaps desperately hopeful for a sign themselves of some real change. Less debate, more hope. A reminder that God shows up in unexpected ways and places. The ways that these two men, John the Baptist and Jesus, surrender to what God calls them to do and to be. I don't mean they give up, or that they walk in some forced march. I mean they let one another influence the other. They find their way into something new for both of them. In Acts, the louder than the question of logistics, I hear that urgency of Paul's question and hope, that we who understand and claim to be believers must do more than just go through the motions. With water and rivers or at fonts, we must receive and know the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit. We must not take it for granted or forget it, for it is both gift and responsibility. As we move into this new year more fully, God, we're halfway through January already. What muscles are you using in the midst of working and reaching and pushing, climbing up the garden fence to find the vegetables? Is there a place where God might be inviting you to yield, to surrender, to give in, to give yourself up so that the grace of God may wash over you? Is there some ritual, sacramental act, some liminal space that you need to lean into? Who could you ask to meet you there? Who could help you say, as Jesus does, let it be? Who could help you say, maybe I'm wrong, and maybe you're right? The stories we tell each other are not always either crazy or misguided or lies. We see the world differently. We have similar and different circles of influence. We have similar and different experiences and life learnings. Some of us were baptized as children or infants, and others as adults, and some of us not at all. Some of us have known intimately the Holy Spirit and the voice of God. Some of us know better the wilderness of wandering and the sweetness of honey and the crunchiness of bugs. Some of us have found our place in the wild of things a long time ago, and some of us are still searching, and some of us once had it and lost it again. This is a weekend when we remember the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Surely there is someone who knew his voice and knew the spirit of the holy. Surely there is someone who knew wilderness and knew vocation. But surely he was also not perfect. He was flawed and broken, sinful and sorrowful, arrogant and angry, wounded and imprisoned. He was a storyteller, like my friend Bob. He was a storyteller and a people gatherer. He was inspired and inspiring. Is it water or spirit that calls to you this morning? Wilderness or city square? Heritage or future? Can we be brave enough to tell our stories truly, that we might better hear one another? Can we both surrender and find grace to call one another to the best of what might be possible? Water or spirit? Yes.
Thank you.
that we open with our prayers for peace in the world, with our prayers for peace when a place where there is war and there is violence, where there has been trauma and disaster. I'm thinking still and again this week of the people of Iran and the people of Hawaii. My prayers are very much in California, where there have been devastating mudslides and loved ones still missing. I would ask your prayers for Beth Nordbeck. Beth had a successful and easy shoulder replacement surgery last week, and she is home recovering with some patients. The rare request is that you pray for Bruce, her caretaker. I have other prayer concerns to share with one another this morning. Elizabeth. Prayers for Elizabeth's niece, Mackenzie, who's struggling with anorexia. Gordon.
For Christy Ward's family, her father, Scott Gal, passed away at home yesterday, less than 2 weeks after being diagnosed with pancreatic cancer.
So our prayers for Christy Ward's family. Christy's dad passed away yesterday after just being diagnosed with pancreatic cancer for a couple weeks. Blair.
I would pray for the lengthening list of those who live under the threat of deportation. It's a long list and nationwide, but to make it more particular, there's a congregation of Presbyterians from Indonesia down in Rochester, whom I mentioned before, and that congregation is really anxious about losing people who are longtime members and breaking up families who have made a life for themselves.
So Blair reminds us of the ever-growing list of those who are living with the fear of deportation. Folks who have found home and safety in this land for generations, particularly our Presbyterian brothers and sisters who live in New Hampshire, who are of Indonesian descent and are quite fearful. We also have UCC congregations in Rochester that are similarly of Indonesian descent and quite fearful. I spent some time in conversation with a colleague whose exclusive ministry is to serve and to help immigrants in the New Haven area yesterday, and the stories that I am hearing of those growing populations are chilling. So our prayers very much for folks. Other prayer concerns? Then let us have some time of silent prayer. Holy and steadfast God, into the stillness of this moment, you come, you have come, and you will come with a radiance and a delight in the ways that we are beautifully and wonderfully made, with an urging and a call for us to see such beauty in one another, no matter where we have been born, or the languages that we speak, or the ways that we have come into the faith, or the faith that we so wish to come into. Be with us on this morning, those of us who grieve, and those of us who fear, those of us who carry an anxiousness about this day and those that are to come, and those of us who carry an arrogance about us, that our way is the right way. Help us to hear one another better. Not not all of our stories are as benign as hungry rabbits in vegetable gardens. They are, in essence, always filled with ways that we witness the world, ways that we must choose how we respond to what is before us, how we must understand the voice that cries to us from the heavens, the waters that surround and perhaps threaten to drown us. Fill us up, bless us, and name us and claim us, and send us out to care for one another, to care for this world, to carry a radiance that we have known in you to share with all who we meet. We pray in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Amen.
I will trust in the Lord. Amen.